but in fact could come about, the diversity of life on Earth could come about by evolution and natural selection. We don't yet understand the origin of life exactly, but we are pretty close. But the one question that seems to require a deity, or at least some people think it requires a deity, is this question. And I've been asked it a lot, and I want to talk about why, in fact, first of all, why it's not an interesting question. So in fact, normally the way it's answered, why is there something rather than nothing, is sort of the, you have a book, you write a book, and you begin it like this, in the beginning, and then you have a long book that tells you nothing about anything. It explains nothing. It was, in this case, was written by Iron Age peasants who didn't even know that the Earth orbited the Sun. And that is supposed to address the why question. And it's appropriate that a book with no real content addresses the why question, because the why question has no content. The why question is not an interesting question, because why questions presume purpose. They presume the answer before you ask the question. If you think about it, if you have children, they will ask you why, and the answer ultimately is only because. And then you say, go to bed. Because why presumes purpose. The really interesting questions are how questions. So whenever the really interesting question is how could a universe, how could something come from nothing? Why is not an interesting question, even though it is the domain of much of all of theology, which is content-free, and much of philosophy, some of which is content-free, as we'll have that discussion later. Not all of which. To answer the question, however, how could something come from nothing, the thing I want to really emphasize is that science has changed the playing field of that question. Science has changed what we mean by that question, because it's changed the definition of something and nothing. It does that a lot. So that's the way science works, as I'll talk about. But I'll probably talk about later because I want to get to the content. What I want to do instead of writing down the answer is I want to be governed by the universe. So this is a picture of the universe as you might see it on the night sky outside of Amsterdam. This happens to be a globular cluster. Doesn't really matter. The night sky is beautiful in the country with full of stars. But the remarkable thing that we've discovered is that the stars are just the tip of a cosmic iceberg. The really important stuff is the stuff you can't see, the stuff between the stars. And that's the stuff that will determine the future of our universe. And it's our understanding of the empty space between the stars that has changed completely. And as we've changed our understanding of empty space, our ideas of nothing have evolved a lot. So that's where I want to go. Okay. Now, I don't have time to give you the full lecture I'd like to give you about the expanding universe. It is rather interesting to realize that less than 100 years ago, a human lifetime ago, the conventional picture in science was that the universe was static and eternal, and there was one galaxy, our own galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. That was the picture that was around in 1916 when Einstein developed general relativity. So we knew there was one galaxy in a static, eternal universe. And that was true until 1925. And it's rather remarkable that we now know that there are at least 100 billion galaxies in our universe. Until 1925, we only knew of one of them. So 87 years ago, we knew of one, now there are 100 billion. That explains why things are so exciting, because we're only just beginning to learn about the universe on the largest scales. We're like the early map makers on Earth. And it's not too surprising that we're often surprised. And in the last two decades, we've been surprised tremendously. Well, all that changed with one of my favorite people, Edwin Hubble, who discovered that, in fact, not only was there not just one galaxy, he first discovered, in fact, that there were other galaxies, but then he made another important discovery, that the universe is expanding. He gives me great hope for humanity every time I think of him, because he began life as a lawyer and then became an astronomer. So there is hope for everyone. In any case, I don't have time to adequately describe his discovery, although we will at some point do an experiment that'll help you understand it in the middle. But he discovered that galaxies were moving away from us, and those galaxies that were twice as far away were twice as moving away from us twice as fast, three times as far away, three times as fast, and so on. And it turns out that does not imply we are the center of the universe, but rather that the universe is expanding. Now, once we realized it's expanding, everything changed. Because, first of all, it wasn't static and eternal, and that meant it had a beginning. That had profound implications, not just for physics, but for philosophy and theology, because the universe indeed had a beginning. We now know that beginning was 13.72 billion years ago. It's amazing we can say it with that kind of precision. Here I can say it. In my country, there are many states where it's 6,000 years old. But we know the answer. But the question then became, if the universe is expanding, will the expansion stop? That became the holy grail of 20th century cosmology. Will the expansion stop? And it turns out that Einstein's general theory of relativity was able to explain the expanding universe, and it said that gravity curves space. And our universe could exist in one of three geometries, so-called open, closed, or flat. And it's impossible to picture them because you can't picture a curved three-dimensional space. None of us can because we're three-dimensional beings. So I draw in here two-dimensional surfaces just to get an idea, a closed universe, an open universe, and a flat universe. And all what's important is that in a closed universe full of matter, the universe will expand and stop and recontract into a big crunch, the reverse of a big bang. An open universe will go on expanding forever, and a flat universe is the boundary between the two. And the question is, which universe do we live in? And that's the question we wanted to resolve so we could know the future. In fact, the reason I got into cosmology as a particle physicist is I wanted to be the first person to know how the universe would end. It seemed like a good idea at the time. Now, I want to show you how we've answered that question. As I say, I don't have much time in this first part, so I'm going to give you the data. And it's very simple. Since matter curves space, all we have to do is weigh the universe. It's really quite simple. You can go out and do it at home tonight. But here's one way we've done it. Here's a picture that's worth a thousand words. This is one way we can weigh the universe. This is a remarkable picture. It's a Hubble Space Telescope picture of a cluster of galaxies. That means every dot in this picture is a galaxy, not a star. Each of these galaxies contains 100 billion stars or so. And this cluster is 5 billion light years away. 5 billion light years. That means the light from those galaxies left those stars 5 billion years ago. They left those stars before our Earth and Sun even formed. So most of those stars don't exist anymore. And any civilizations around those stars are probably gone. So every time I look at a picture like this, I find it remarkable and inspiring to think of all the civilizations that may have existed that are now gone. But clusters of galaxies are the largest bound objects in the universe. That means anything that can fall into anything will fall into a cluster. So if we can weigh the clusters, we can weigh the universe. And this picture allows us to weigh them using a phenomena that Einstein first predicted, but he said would never be observed because he underestimated observers. In this cluster, and clusters are about, 10 million light years across. So the distance from there to there is about 10 million light years. That means it takes light 10 million years to go from there to there. That's how big this system is. But you notice in this system there are weird blue things. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to see them. They're different than the rest. This is a phenomenon Einstein first predicted called gravitational lensing. He realized that matter can curve space, and if I have a big mass here, and I have a source of light behind that mass, the light can go around and be curved and come back and be focused, just like my glasses focus things. And I can magnify objects. Or if I had a cut glass goblet, or if I look through one of these glasses here, I could see many, many versions of you in the room. And he realized that space itself could act like a lens if you put matter in it. He didn't think it would be observable, but here it is. What we now know is that all these blue things are multiple images of a single galaxy located 5 billion light years behind that cluster, 10 billion light years away, most of the way back to the Big Bang, in fact. And we see all these different images because the light is magnified and distorted. So this is proof, if you wish, that spaces can be curved by a matter distribution. But the nice thing is we understand general relativity, so we can work backwards and say, given this image, where is the mass here, and how much of it must there be to form the image? It's a complicated mathematical process called a mathematical inversion, but we can do it. And here's what this looks like. When you ask, where is the mass in this system? Well, here's the system of galaxies. And the spikes are where the galaxies are. But what you notice is this huge mountain of mass where the galaxies aren't. There's 40 times as much mass in that system as can be accounted for by the galaxies alone. 40 times as much mass. Most of it doesn't shine. And we say, in fact, physicists with their great creativity have called that dark matter, because it doesn't shine. And what's very exciting about it is that there's so much of it that we know it can't be made of the same stuff as you and me. It can't be made of protons and neutrons or the normal particles that make up everything in this room. It must be made of some new type of elementary particle. Something totally foreign, something not that doesn't make up anything on Earth, because there's not enough protons and neutrons in the universe to make up that much mass. And that's very exciting, because that means it's not just out there in these galaxies and in the rest of our galaxy, it's in this room, going right through your bodies as you nod off during this lecture here. And that means we can do experiments here on Earth to look for it. And in fact, I think I'll come back here. And here's an experiment we're building underground to look for it. You take a little bit of silicon, cool it down, or germanium, the stuff that makes up your computers. You cool it down to 1/1000th of a degree above absolute zero, put it deep underground, and wait. Most of the time, there's these new particles we think will go right through the Earth without even knowing it was there. But every now and then, one, we hope, will bounce off the germanium and heat it up by a little bit, and we'll measure it. So there are detectors like this in Europe, in the United States, in Asia, underground, looking for this dark matter. And one day we may find it. You'll read about it. And most of the time you'll read about it and it'll be wrong. But maybe one time it'll be right. And we first proposed these 25 years ago, and there are experiments around the world looking for it. But it doesn't matter what it is. By the way, the other I should mention, since I'm here, it's kind of an exciting time. Because if we discover these dark matter particles, they'll be particles that were created at the beginning of time. And we'll learn a lot about the Big Bang. But there's another way to find dark matter particles, and that's to create them right now. Where would you create them? Well, you'd go to a place that recreates the conditions of the Big Bang, or very close to the Big Bang. And there's a place in Europe that does, the Large Hadron Collider, and over a very small region. And so right now, there's a competition between the experimentalists at the Large Hadron Collider who are trying to produce these particles directly and detect them, and the people building these detectors underground. We don't know who will win, or we don't know if anyone will win, but in this exciting time. But as I say, it doesn't matter what they are. We can determine how much of them there are. Because by looking at this, we can weigh this cluster, and we weigh all clusters, and we have finally, after 80 years, got the answer for whether the universe, or how much matter there is, and if there's enough to close the universe or make it flat. And the answer is, and there's a drum roll, and here's the answer, and I can hear several of you fainting right now. So excited. In physics, whenever we get a big number, we give it a Greek letter so we sound scholarly, so we can communicate with philosophers. And we call this omega. And what's omega? Omega is the ratio of the actual amount of matter in the universe divided by the amount of matter it would take to make the universe exactly flat. So if omega is less than 1, the universe is open. And if omega is greater than 1, the universe is closed, and now we have determined, finally, after 8 years of trying with great accuracy, reasonably good accuracy anyway, that there's not enough matter to make the universe flat. The universe appears to be open, because omega is 0.3. So this is amazing, except we theorists knew that was wrong. Because we always know the answers. We're not always right, but we always know the answers. And we knew that the universe we lived in had to be a flat universe. And here these awful observers were coming up, as they tend to do, with the wrong answer. Now, why do we know we live in a flat universe? Because it's the only mathematically beautiful universe. And something else, which I'll tell you after the break. And so there was a big problem. But there's a problem, you see, with weighing the universe this way, because we're weighing all the stuff in and around galaxies and clusters of galaxies, but maybe we could miss stuff. So there's another way to weigh the universe directly that I want to tell you about. And that's this. If you look at these two-dimensional universes, you'll notice in a flat universe, if you draw a triangle, Everyone in, well, at least everyone in Europe knows what that the sum of the angles in a triangle is 180 degrees. In the United States, that would be a difficult problem. But you notice that if we have an open universe or a closed universe, the triangles are different, and the sum of the angles need not be 180 degrees. Well, that's true not just for two-dimensional surfaces, in fact, but for curved three-dimensional universes. So it was realized if we could find a big enough triangle and just measure the angles, we could actually determine directly the curvature of the universe. And that was possible with one of the most important observations in cosmology, something called the cosmic microwave background, the afterglow of the Big Bang. In the early universe, it was very hot. It was so hot that matter was ionized, and it interacted strongly with radiation, and radiation couldn't get out as it tried to move about. It kept scattering off matter. But when the universe was about 100,000 years old, it cooled down to the point where hydrogen, which is the dominant stuff, protons captured electrons, and matter became neutral when the universe was 100,000 years old. Neutral matter is transparent to radiation. So if we look out in all directions, we should expect to see a surface located far away from us at a time when the universe was 100,000 years old, and only then could the light come to us, because only then could the universe become transparent. That surface is called the surface of last scattering. If we could take a picture of that surface, we get a picture of what the universe looked like when it was only 100,000 years old, a baby picture of the universe. And we've been able to take such a picture. Indeed, here it is. Now, it turns out that radiation, when the universe was 100,000 years old, the temperature of the universe was 3,000 degrees. It's cooled a lot. It's cooled by a factor of 1,000, and that radiation is cooled, and the radiation occurs in the microwave band. So we have microwave receivers, and this is an experiment that was designed to look for it. This is Antarctica. It was put on a balloon, and this balloon went around the world, which is easy to do in Antarctica. If you're at the South Pole, you just do this. But it wasn't at the South Pole. It was close to that. It went around in a circle. It was called the boomerang experiment. It took 2 weeks. And it looked at the microwave background, and it took an image. And these are hot spots and cold spots in the microwave background. These are the primordial structures which would later collapse to form all the galaxies, all the stars, all the people, all the aliens, everything. And here is the baby picture of those things. And these lumps, by the way, we think were created at the beginning of time. We may talk about that later. It's an amazing picture. And in fact, a Nobel Prize was given more or less for this picture. But the important thing is the size of these, because gravity travels at the speed of light. And that means if I have a lump, if the universe is 100,000 years old, that means light can travel 100,000 light years across. If I have a lump that's bigger than 100,000 light years across, it doesn't even know it's a lump. It doesn't know it's supposed to collapse. In my country, we had a cartoon called The Roadrunner when I was a kid, and I don't know if you had it here. Did you have it here? Okay, and you remember, Wile E. Coyote runs off the cliff, and he stands there for a while waiting to see before he should collapse. That's the way it is for a big lump. Only lumps 100,000 light years or less should know to collapse. So the biggest lumps that should collapse are 100,000 light years across. But that allows us a way to determine the curvature of the universe. Because we have a ruler that's 100,000 light years across, a known distance away from us. If we connect the ends of the ruler to my eye, if light travels in straight lines, it turns out those lumps should look like they're 1 degree across. But in an open universe, where light rays curve outward that way, the lumps will look smaller, maybe half a degree. In a closed universe where light curves inward like that, the lumps will look bigger. So all we have to do is take this picture and ask how big are these lumps. We know they're 100,000 light years across, and we ask how big are they, and that allows us to determine the geometry of the universe directly. And here's a different false color image. And you should know I'm almost done, so that the first half. So. Here's a different false color image of the same reason. And here are universes we've created on a computer. And in a closed universe, 100,000 light year across lumps should be about that big. But it's bigger than these lumps. In an open universe, the 100,000 light year across lumps should be about that big, as these little blue things. but those are smaller than these lumps. But just like Goldilocks, in a flat universe, it's just right. And now we know from having measured the geometry of the universe directly that the universe is flat, to an accuracy of about 1%. So we can pat ourselves on the back, us theorists. But there's a problem. I just convinced you that the universe is open. It was only 30% of the amount of stuff needed to make a flat universe there when you weigh it. Where is the other 70%? Well, if it's not where the galaxies are, it must be where the galaxies aren't. But what is where the galaxies aren't? Nothing. So, all I have to do is give nothing energy and I solve the problem. Well, it turns out, general relativity tells me if I give nothing energy, then it's very strange. If I put energy into empty space, it's not gravitationally attractive like all other kinds of energy. It's gravitationally repulsive. So if I look at the expansion of the universe, if I put energy into empty space, and it's the dominant energy of the universe, instead of slowing down as any universe should do over time, it'd speed up. Well, in 1998, two groups of astronomers who didn't really know what they were doing decided to measure the rate at which the universe was slowing down. And what did they discover? This was the cover of Science magazine. It's kind of difficult, but I'll show it to you. Here's the expansion rate of the universe as a function of time, if you wish. And I can draw a straight line through this data set and bring the whole thing horizontally. And what really matters is, it turns out, for reasons you can ask me about later, if the universe were slowing down, all of these data points, these are exploding stars that are seen very far distances away, would fall on this curve. But much to the surprise of the observers, these didn't fall on this curve. They didn't even fall on the straight line. They fell above the straight line. What would that mean? Well, that only two explanations of that are possible. One, the data is wrong, which is usually the case. Or two, the expansion of the universe is speeding up. And just for fun, if I ask how much energy would I have to add to empty space to make the expansion speed up just the right amount to fit the data, I find out if I put 70% of the energy of a flat universe into empty space, I fit the data. But that's exactly what we were missing. So, this suggests we're now at the almost at the end of this first part of the talk, so I want to summarize. First, the first thing I want to tell you is you're much more insignificant than you thought. Because everything we see is just a bit of pollution in a universe dominated by dark matter and this stuff we call dark energy. Everything we see accounts for 1% of the total energy of the universe. 99%, well, about 30% comes in dark matter and almost 70% in dark energy. So everything you could get rid of in the night sky, those beautiful stars that you saw, we could get rid of all the stars and all the galaxies and the universe would be largely the same. We are just a sideshow. So much for a universe made for us. We are insignificant in the extreme. It's the first thing I want you to leave with this, remembering, okay? The second thing, which I'll talk about after the break, is that the future is miserable, okay? But I just want to say, well, this sounds so crazy that I could put energy in empty space. Intuition, how can you do that? And I just want to point out, and this will come back later, that empty space isn't so simple. And this will come back when we talk about nothing after the break. We now understand, due to the laws of quantum mechanics and relativity, that empty space is a boiling, bubbling brew of virtual particles that pop in and out of existence in a time scale so short you can't measure them. And this is what the space inside of a proton, every proton and neutron in your body, what your body's made up of these things, this is an actual mathematical calculation of what the space inside of a proton looks like. It was actually shown in the Nobel Prize ceremonies in 2004 by the people who produced the theory that allowed us to do this calculation, much of which depended on a good friend of mine here in Holland who won the Nobel Prize earlier for allowing us to know how to do the mathematics of that. But these are the virtual fields that pop in and out of existence, and that fact, you may say, well, how do we know we're there? It turns out they're responsible for 90% of the mass of the protons and neutrons in your body. If empty space didn't pop these things in and out of existence, you wouldn't be in existence. So, if we can take the theory and understand these fields give energy to empty space, shouldn't we be able to understand the energy of empty space outside of protons? After all, we get the right answer for inside protons. We do the same calculation, and we come up with the worst prediction in all of physics, so bad that it's off the screen. We calculate that the energy of empty space should be roughly a gazillion times the energy of everything we see. It is the worst prediction in all of physics. It was so bad that we never talked about it. We predict that the energy of empty space should be 120 orders of magnitude bigger than it actually is. And we thought the answer used to be, well, the calculation's obviously wrong, so it must be zero. The only sensible number for the energy of empty space is zero, and we used to be able to go to bed. But now we know the energy of empty space is not zero, but it's 120 orders of magnitude smaller than our theories predict, and we don't have the slightest understanding of why. So that's where we're at. The biggest mystery in nature is that empty space has energy. We don't understand why it has the value it has. And so, to summarize for this part of the talk, first, the dominant energy of the universe resides in empty space. We don't have the slightest idea why it's there. And if anyone comes and gives one of these science cafes, or whatever they're called, and tells you, especially if they're a string theorist, they're lying. We think its existence is probably tied to the very nature of space, and it will determine our future. So that's the starting point of the mystery. This is the universe we live in, a cockamamie universe dominated by dark matter, whose identity we don't understand, and dark energy, which is even stranger. But that's the way it is, in a flat universe. But that picture is amazing, because what it's told us is that it is quite plausible. If you ask what would be the characteristics of a universe that were created from nothing by just simple laws of physics, without God, what would that universe look like? It would look just like the universe we live in. So that's the end of the first half of the talk. Now, we have a gentleman here who's going to tell you how we know the universe is expanding.
Yes.
Mr. Hubble, I'll just give you an introduction for a second. Mr. Hubble discovered the universe was expanding. How did he do that? He saw that galaxies were moving away from us. And the further they were away from us, the faster they were moving. I had a cartoon, but I forgot to put it on here for you.
Okay.
It's two cowboys on the plane looking at a train, and one says to the other, "I love hearing the lonesome wail of the train whistle as the magnitude of the frequency of the wave changes due to the Doppler effect." And the point is, when Mr. Hubble looked at distant stars, he saw that the frequency of the light of those distant stars was changing. And maybe now, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you. Hi.
It's called Lucas Kaining from Science Center NEMO.
That's
Lucas.
Right. Good evening. Thank you. I would like to demonstrate you the Doppler effect, and you might all know it from out of the streets. When you hear a police car or an ambulance arriving, the pitch of the siren is higher. It goes when it moves away from you, the pitch goes down. And I would like to demonstrate it with this toy siren, and then later on explain why it happens for those of you who might not know, and then link it to star research because it has it's the same effect. It's not the nicest sound, but it's the best I could get from Intertoys. When I turn it on, the siren will give you two tones, and it will stay the same most of the time, or it will stay the same. And then I go with the cowboy cartoon, would be very appropriate, because I will do it like a lasso above my head, will swing it around, and listen very carefully to what the tones will do. Do they stay the same, or something happens, maybe? This is it. Can somebody say, do the tones stay the same when I swing it around? You think they do? Who thinks they don't? Like, they don't stay the same, right? They get out of pitch, like, or in Dutch, the false, the toner word false. Maybe for the, I can, I can explain what happens with the next slide. It's the same thing what happens sort of when the police car is arriving. Sound travels in waves, and the waves have a certain distance. When the police car is arriving to you, or approaching you, sound can only travel with a certain speed. So the waves will be get shorter. They are pressed together, so to speak. And if a sound wave, that length of the wave, has to do with the pitch of the sound. The shorter the wave, the higher the pitch. So if the police car is approaching you, the sound waves become shorter, and the pitch will go up. And if it's moving away from you, for just that slide, the previous one, please. For the girl, the police car is moving away from her, and the waves are, so to speak, lengthened up. They become longer, and the sound goes down. And the same thing happens when I move it around above my head. Half of the time, the siren is coming towards you with quite a speed, and that makes the wave shorter. And half of the time, the sound is source of the sound is moving away from you. And the same thing happens with that. Do it again. Yeah. Okay. So now it's the same. Yeah, fuck. Excusez mon français. So the same things happens with light. If we can move to the next slide, you can see light as particles, but also as waves, and the same things happens with the color of the stars. Like physicists know what kind of color needs to come from a star. And when a star or a whole galaxy moves away from us, the wavelength, because it does it with such a velocity that it influences the light, when it moves away from us, the color of the stars become more red. It's just a very slight difference, so you won't see it with your own eyes, but physicists and telescopes can do that. And when it moves towards us, the wavelengths become shorter, relatively, and the color will become more blue. So this way, with the same as with the siren, a physicist can tell at what speed and in which direction the stars are moving towards or from us. So that's my demonstration. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Rebecca?
Go ahead.
Thank you. Good. Now we get back to the universe. Oops. Okay. So that's the universe we live in. Now, what are the implications of that? Well, I want to tell you why we theorists really knew the universe was flat. And I want to take you back to one of your favorite times. Physics class in high school. So if I take a coin and I throw it up in the air, I think I have a coin. I throw it up in the air, it comes, the lights I won't be able to see, it comes back down. If I throw it up higher, it comes back down, but it takes longer. If I throw it up really high, it doesn't come back down at all, if there's no ceiling. And we know how to do that. NASA knows how to do that. We just send it with the escape velocity from the Earth. But we teach high school students how to calculate the escape velocity. And I want to remind you, we say that when I throw the coin up, it has some energy. And that energy comes in two pieces. This brings back pleasant memories for everyone, I'm sure. There are two pieces, but all that matters, this is called the kinetic energy that depends upon the speed of the thing. And the point is, it's positive. This is called the potential energy, which is due to the pull of the Earth, and it's negative. And then the question of whether a ball or a coin escapes from the Earth just becomes accounting. Because if the total energy is greater than zero, if this piece beats that piece, the coin will escape. If the total energy is less than zero, if that piece beats that piece, the coin will return to the Earth. And that's how we calculate the escape velocity from the Earth. It's simple. Well, the universe is expanding, and we can do exactly the same thing. We can look out at the universe. We're at the center. These are galaxies, not sperm, but in any case, if we're, this is our galaxy, and we look at some region of the universe and everything's moving away from us by this Doppler effect, as was just discussed, we can look at one given galaxy and ask, what's its energy? And again, its energy comes in two pieces. The positive piece comes from the speed of its moving away, but that comes from the expansion rate of the universe that Mr. Hubble measured. So just by measuring that the galaxies are moving away from us, we get the positive piece. What's the negative piece? The negative piece is the mass of all the stuff inside that sphere that's pulling the galaxy in. So you can do this at home. Go out tonight, build a telescope, and measure the expansion rate of the universe, and then gravitational lensing to get the density. And all that matters, you see, is if B over A, if this term is bigger than that term, if B over A is bigger than 1, if that means the negative piece is bigger than the positive piece, this galaxy will stop and come back. And if it does, if the universe is the same everywhere, all galaxies will stop and come back. So if B over A is bigger than 1, the universe will collapse. If B over A is less than 1, so the positive piece beats the negative piece, the universe will expand forever. But what is absolutely amazing is it turns out this ratio B over A is nothing other than this quantity omega, which I told you about earlier. And we measured that we live in a flat universe. That means omega is exactly 1. And what does that mean? That means B is exactly equal to A. What does that mean? That means the total energy of every object in the universe, the total gravitational energy of every object in the universe, is 0. And that's why a flat universe is so beautiful. Because if you were going to create a universe from nothing, what would you make the total gravitational energy of every object? 0. And this is the first inkling that perhaps it's possible to create a whole universe from nothing. So, this is what I just said. It's the first inkling that perhaps the universe could come from nothing. But how could it? Well, we have to be a little careful when we define nothing in physics, because we've got to ask what it is. So, the first kind of nothing I want to talk about would be the nothing of the Bible. Empty space, an eternal, dark, empty void. Well, the simplest answer to why there's something rather than nothing in such a universe is quite simple. The surprising thing would not be that there's something. The surprising thing would be if there's nothing. But if there were nothing, we wouldn't be around to ask the question. Because it turns out, due to the laws of quantum mechanics and gravity, if you wait long enough, nothing will always form something. Remember what the space inside of a proton looked like, these virtual fields popping in and out of existence? Well, they go into existence and they come out of existence because they take energy. To create the field takes energy, and then you can borrow the energy from nothing, but you have to return it. So that's why quantum mechanics says these fields pop in and out of existence. But once you allow for gravitational interactions of particles, you can create particles, a particle-antiparticle pair, whose total energy is 0. Because the gravitational energy, the negative energy, will counter the positive energy that it takes to create them. And once you create a pair with total energy 0, they can exist forever. So quantum mechanics says these processes are random. So if you have empty space and you wait long enough, you'll always create particles. Empty space is unstable. Nothing is unstable. So as I say, the surprising thing would not be that there's a lot of stuff in the universe. The surprising thing would be that if there were nothing in the universe. We're asking the wrong question. It's not surprising at all. This question that used to surprise the ancients and the philosophers in the old days was surprising to them just because they didn't know about quantum mechanics. That's okay. We've actually learned something. That's a good thing. Except for theologians who haven't learned anything. Because they still adhere to these Iron Age books that don't tell you anything. Okay. So in such a world, once we realize there's quantum mechanics and gravity, you always can create something from empty space. You don't need any supernatural shenanigans. Okay, but some people would say, well, okay, look, that's fine, but that's not nothing. Where did the space come from? And that's a valid question. Well, it turns out, once you make gravity a quantum theory, gravity is a theory of space and time. That's what Einstein told us. Once you try and make it a quantum theory, and I should say we don't yet have a quantum theory of gravity, but any quantum theory of gravity will be a quantum theory of space and time. And in such a theory, not only can particles pop in and out of existence in space, but spaces themselves can pop in and out of existence. They must in any quantum theory of gravity. You will create spaces and times that didn't exist before. There was no space, no time, and suddenly, poof, a universe can pop into existence, but most of the time it'll go out of existence because it violates energy conservation for it to exist for very long. But if you create a universe with zero total energy, it can survive forever. Now, it sounds like we've got a grand synthesis because I just told you our universe, the one we live in, a flat universe, has zero gravitational energy for every object. And I'd love that to be the end of the story, but it's a little more subtle. Because in addition to gravitational energy, there's the energy of rest mass. Einstein told us E equals mc squared. So the gravitational energy isn't everything. It turns out there's only one kind of universe that has zero total energy. And it's not a flat universe, it's a closed universe. We don't know. It turns out we can't do the calculations for a flat universe and an open universe. We don't know how to do those calculations. But for a closed universe, we know it's zero. But we don't live in a closed universe. But most closed universes, as I say, expand, stop, and contract. And most closed universes that created at the beginning of time will last a fraction of a second before they collapse again. How can you make a closed universe last long enough for us to be here to talk about it? 14 billion years. The only way you can do it, it turns out, is to give empty space energy at the beginning of time. Because if you give empty space energy, then the universe will start speeding up and it will expand faster and faster and faster. And in fact, particle physics predicts that there should be a phase in our universe in which it expanded by a huge amount, 10 to the 90th in volume, in a time of a millionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second. It's amazing. This is called inflation. It came out of particle physics, but all of our theories predict that will happen in order to explain the universe we see. In fact, if that happens, one of the predictions of inflation is you'll produce lumps due to quantum mechanics, and those lumps will look just like the lumps we measure in the cosmic white wave background. So we're pretty certain that inflation happened. But what happens when you puff up a universe by such a big value? Well, if I blow up a balloon by a huge amount, say the size of the Earth, it looks flat. You can't see the curvature. If you blow up our universe by a huge value, it will look flat on any scale we can measure. So the only closed universe that could, and I think I'm going to skip, I had an example with beer because I was here, but I'm going to skip it. And I'll skip the Higgs. I'll talk about that later. There's my beer again. And we can listen for the Doppler effect. Okay. It will force the universe to look flatter. And so the only universe that can have been created from nothing and survive as long as this has is a flat universe, or one that looks like a flat universe with zero total energy. And that's the universe we live in. So what we've seen is that we can't say for certain that our universe came from nothing. But if we had to ask what are the characteristics of a universe that could have been created by a quantum process that could survive for 14 billion years, those characteristics would be precisely those of the universe we measure. And so, as I like to say, if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. But some people would say that's not nothing. Because after all, you don't have any particles. You don't have any space, but you got the laws of nature. Where did the laws of nature come from? Well, it turns out even the laws of nature themselves may be an accident. They may have been created when our universe came into being. And the argument, I wish I had time to do it justice, but when we measure this energy of empty space, actually, you're going to read that, so I'll stop it, okay? Because I don't want you to read, I want you to listen. It's like students in class, they always read and they don't listen. The energy of empty space, as I told you, is completely inexplicable. It's 120 orders of magnitude smaller than we predicted. We don't have any theoretical understanding of that. But one theoretical bit of understanding suggests, well, maybe it's an accident. Maybe there are many universes, And in each universe, the energy of empty space is a different value. It turns out if the energy of empty space were much bigger than we measure it to be, galaxies wouldn't have formed. And if galaxies didn't form, stars wouldn't form. And if stars didn't form, planets wouldn't form. And if planets didn't form, astronomers wouldn't form. So, the argument has been suggested, in fact, that maybe there are many different universes and the energy of empty space is what it is, only so that galaxies can form, and only then will stars and astronomers form. And therefore, the universe is the way it is because there are astronomers here to measure it. That sounds ridiculous. But it's not. It sounds like a tautology or it sounds religious. It's neither. It's just a kind of cosmic natural selection. We would be very surprised to find ourselves in a universe in which we couldn't live. And it's like evolution. Before Darwin, everything looked like a miracle. Bees could tell the color of flowers so they could find stuff to nectar and but in fact they weren't designed to do it. If they couldn't, they wouldn't survive and reproduce. Similarly, this is kind of cosmic natural selection. We are in the universe in which we can live. And this fundamental quantity is just an accident if there are many universes. Now, particle physicists are way ahead of cosmologists because in cosmology, there's one number we don't understand, the energy of empty space. But particle physicists are way ahead because in particle physics, there are many more numbers we haven't understood for much longer. Okay? Such as, why is gravity the weakest force in nature? Why is the proton 2,000 times the mass of the electron? Why are there three generations of elementary particles? We don't understand any of that. And people like me were educated, hopefully, so we could come up with a theoretical prediction that would explain why all this is the case. But particle physicists have jumped on this idea of anthropic principles and said, this is great. Maybe we don't have to understand anything. Maybe it's all an accident. Maybe all the fundamental quantities are accidental, and then we don't need a theory of everything, we just need a theory of anything. Well, we have such a theoretical candidate, it's called string theory, and I'll give you a one-slide summary of string theory. One guy said to another, I just had an awesome idea, suppose all matter and energy is made of tiny vibrating strings. Second person says, okay, what would that imply? First person says, I don't know. So that's a history of string theory for the last 40 years. Because people thought it would be a theory of everything, but unfortunately it's got 11 extra dimensions, you have to compactify 6 or 7 of them, and then every different way you compactify them produces a different universe. In fact, it's been argued there might be 10 to the 500 different possible four-dimensional universes like the one we live in that might come from a single string theory. That used to be bad news. But in string theory, every wart becomes a beauty mark, and now it's the landscape for the anthropic principle. And maybe it's true. Maybe every different universe, different way of compactifying 11 dimensions produces different laws of physics, and only in those in which what we observe is true will we arise. And maybe that's the reason things are the way they are. It's really depressing for someone like me because it says physics is just an environmental science. It's an accident. And it's awful, but maybe it's true. But if it's true, you see, every time the universe pops into existence, new laws of physics arise when it does. So even the laws of physics may be accidental. And so we've got no particles, no space, no laws. That's a pretty good approximation of nothing. And in such a universe where there are many, such a system which have many possible universes, we call it a multiverse. And that multiverse serves, if you wish, the ancients and the Catholic Church, pretty well the same thing, used to wonder how could you get a universe. How could you create a universe without having a creator that existed outside of space and outside of time? Call that God. But you now see that in such a multiverse, which may have many, many universes, the multiverse serves the role of a prime mover or God. Now, we didn't invent it because we didn't like God, although I don't happen to like God. We invented it because the laws of physics are driving us to that notion. But if it's true, it gets around, if you wish, that philosophical problem of what is there anything that could exist outside of our universe. Our universe came into existence from literally nothing, as did many other universes, some of which are only coming into existence today, and other ones of which are going out of existence today. Okay, the last thing before we'll go to questions and then some interesting discussion, I hope. In deference to my late, very good friend, Christopher Hitchens, who was a remarkable man and recently died. When I used to, Christopher was writing the foreword for my new book when he died, and I wish he'd finished it. I used to explain physics to him, and when I talked to him about the future of the universe, he said, you know, nothing is heading towards us as fast as can be. Because let's think of the future of the universe. What's going to happen in the future? Well, the universe is expanding faster and faster and faster if dark energy is filling it up. That means that the galaxies we now see are moving away from us faster and faster and faster, and in fact, eventually, they'll be moving away from us faster than the speed of light. It's allowed in general relativity. When they are, we won't be able to see them. And that means if we wait long enough, the rest of the universe will disappear. The longer we wait, the less we'll see. It's already started happening now. And in a mere cosmic instant, 100 billion to a trillion years, all of the galaxies we now see, all 100 billion of them, will disappear. And if let's think about, but stars will still exist in our galaxy, and planets will exist around those stars, and observers will evolve, and I'm in the Netherlands, so I can say the word evolve. In some of the Netherlands. And so planets, civilizations will evolve on those planets, and they'll get astronomers, and they'll discover the laws of physics and chemistry and electromagnetism and gravity. They'll build telescopes, they'll look out, and what will they think they live in? They'll think they live in the universe we thought we lived in 100 years ago. They'll think they'll live in a universe with a single galaxy surrounded by vast, eternal, empty space. There'll be no evidence of the expansion anymore. All of that will have disappeared. I find it very poetic that the far future, they'll come up with the picture we had 100 years ago. They'll do the best falsifiable science they can do, and they'll come up with the false answer. But eventually, the stars in our galaxy will burn out too, and the universe will become cold, dark, and empty. And then, as Christopher would say, the answer to the question, why is there something rather than nothing, is really quite simple. Just wait, there won't be for long. And to me, that's the best answer of all, because it demonstrates our incredible conceit as a human species, that somehow the universe we live in is the ultimate universe. It was there, and it just reached its pinnacle, and it's always going to be like this, but it isn't. We're here for a brief moment when the universe is the way it is, and it won't be this way for long or forever. So once again, so much for a universe made for us. But this brings us to my last point. The future is miserable. Because an unexamined life is not worth living, and when most of the rest of the universe has disappeared, we won't be able to know what's happening. It's a miserable, miserable future. So I remind you once again, you are insignificant, the future is miserable, and let me summarize. Science has demonstrated that the universe from nothing is not only plausible, but likely. We can't prove it, but the fact that it's plausible is worth celebrating. We can get rid of a ton of myths. Just like it's plausible that life, that biology originated from chemistry. And the question is, how can we understand if it did? More importantly, and this will become relevant probably for our discussion later, I'm not sure, what we mean by something and nothing has completely changed from the time the classical philosophers and theologians first raised the question. And I remind you of what I said at the beginning. The interesting question isn't why is there something rather than nothing. The interesting questions are, how did the universe evolve and how can we find out? And that's what we're doing science to do. So, in this universe in which you are insignificant and the future is miserable, you should be happy. Because the meaning in our lives is the meaning we make. We are here at this brief, random moment in time in the middle of nowhere, yet we have evolved a consciousness that allows us to understand the universe back to its earliest moments and out to the far future. And that means instead of taking some solace from some imaginary being, we should take the meaning in our own lives and use our brains and enjoy our brief moment in the sun. Thank you very much. Yes.
Now? Yeah.
Questions?
Perfect. Yeah, okay. Questions. Thank you, Lawrence. Thank you so much. The future is miserable. Well, so much for that. Okay. But we should enjoy, like you said.
Let's enjoy.
Let's enjoy some
right
questions
now.
Then.
Okay.
Anyone? Questions?
We have some time for questions.
Yes. Okay. Wait for the mic, please. If you like, you can speak in Dutch, and we'll try to translate. But
I can do it in English. Okay, no problem. So one of the things you said is that everything needs to be the way it is, because or else it wouldn't have worked.
sort of.
But are there different variations of the four main forces, as well as the energy level that could be higher up? Maybe different particles or whatever, maybe even different laws of physics. Is that something you try and find out?
Actually, that's a remarkably good question. I happen to hate the anthropic principle, let me point out, but it may be true. And the answer is, we just simply don't know. Those people who argue we can answer these questions because of that, the problem with the anthropic principle is it depends on probabilities. What's the probability of forming a universe that with our laws, and how typical are we? Because as you point out, if we change one thing, like the energy of empty space, it's true, you don't form galaxies. But what if I change a lot of things at the same time, and I have different particles, different forces? Is it impossible to have any conscious life? We don't know the answer. That's why no one can do a rigorous mathematical definition and defense of the anthropic principle. It's a vague notion. And in fact, to be even fairer, the anthropic principle has been arisen several times in the last century. Whenever something so striking and unexpected arose that people couldn't explain it, they said maybe it's an accident. Every other time, it hasn't worked out to be an accident. We understood the underlying laws that force things to be the way they are. Does that mean we'll understand it now? I don't know. It's an open question. But your point is very well taken. In fact, I've written scientific papers demonstrating the flaws in this argument if we're not typical. If we are typical of all kinds of life that can exist, I can prove these things mathematically. If we're not, you can show that you can't do anything predictive, and I make some toy models where I show that's not the case. But the answer is, in real life, we don't know. We just don't know the answer.
Is there any experiment or theory to prove or disprove
this?
Well,
no. First of all, you need to know a theory that told you what the different possibilities were and what the probability measures for every different possibility was for the different laws. We don't even have such a... I mean, string theory would provide such a thing if you could actually calculate with string theory, which you can't do. And if string theory were right, for which we have no evidence. So right now, it's just pure speculation. But it's speculation motivated by the fact that the energy of empty space seems to be 120 orders of magnitude different than any sensible fundamental theory should predict it should be. The really neat thing would be to come up with a fundamental theory that got the right answer, and then all these people would stop talking.
Would be boring.
Well, I mean, no, because the theory would presumably predict other things that are stranger.
Okay, we'll wait for that then.
Yes.
Working on it?
Of course.
Okay, next question. Yes,
today, in fact.
If I understood you correctly, you believe in the cosmological natural selection.
I don't believe in it. Let me make one thing.
My question is goes beyond that. If there is such a thing as cosmological natural selection, in analogy to Darwin, you should look for the fossils in our universe. And then my question is, aren't dark matter and dark energy the fossils of the cosmological natural selection?
Well, that's a very good, the way you put it is a very good question, but I do want to hit some word you said, believe. Scientists should not use the word believe. Belief is not a part of science. I can say, is something likely or is it unlikely? I don't believe anything, okay? And scientists, and I use it all the time myself, and I'm trying to wean myself away from that word. Belief is a bad word. It leads to things like religion. Okay? I'll applaud to that. And so the question is cosmological natural selection a likely idea? And you're absolutely right. We should look for fossils, and that's what we're trying to do. And in fact, the microwave background is a beautiful fossil of the early universe, as is dark matter and dark energy. We're trying to use those bits of observations. And as I tell you, that they all lend support to the idea of cosmological natural selection, in the sense that they all lend support to the idea of inflation. And the minute you have inflation, it turns out you will create many universes. So we can't say for certain. The fossil record is still very, very weak, but it's suggestive. It's sort of like where we were before we knew about the Cambrian explosion in terms of the origins of life and the diversity of life. We got evidence, and Darwin had lots of evidence. Most of it wasn't fossil evidence. It was evidence by looking at living species. finches, for example, on different islands. But the evidence got better and better over time, and the reason we want to build new telescopes, the reasons we want to build new particle accelerators are to look for better and better fossils. Because if we don't keep asking, let me put it even more strongly. The universe, what I try and remind people of is that the universe is the way it is, whether we like it or not. It doesn't give a damn what we want, or what we like, or what we wish, or what gives us solace, or happiness, or pleasure. It could care less. It is the way it is. And the only way we'll find out the way it is not thinking about it or talking about it, but looking at it. And that's why we need to continue to do experiments on the small scales and the larger scales if we want to understand our own origins.
Next question. Wait for the mic, please.
Okay. I have a question related to the experimental side of physics. The 4th of July was a great day for experimental physics. They discovered the Higgs particle.
Mm-hmm.
What does it mean for you as a cosmologist? I saw you had one slide about Higgs.
I mentioned the Higgs. I've written many, many articles about the Higgs when it first came out for newspapers and magazines, because the Higgs is remarkably important. And I would love to give you a 10-minute explanation of it, which I won't, because I've already gone over time. But the Higgs is the cap of the most remarkable intellectual journey the humans have ever taken. The standard model of particle physics, which 40 years ago we understood one of the four forces in nature. We now understand three of the four forces in nature with the fundamental quantum theory, and we understand all four have the same mathematical form. A mathematical form which lends itself to calculation due to my good friend, whose name I don't pronounce right, Gerard Tuft, who's here, won the Nobel Prize, Martinus Veltman. They allowed us to calculate with those theories. And we now understand those theories. But a key part of those theories is this weird fact that two forces of nature, two of the four forces, electromagnetism and the weak force, we now understand are different representations of the same force. But that's crazy, because the electromagnetic force operates over the entire scale of the universe, but the weak force operates only over the size of an atomic nucleus. Well, we understand that because the weak force is mediated, forces in quantum mechanics are mediated by particles. And electromagnetism is mediated by a particle which has zero mass, called the photon. Photons can travel across the universe. The weak forces are mediated by particles that have very big mass. And that turns out the reason that it's not only very weak, but very short range. But how can they be representative of the same force if those particles are heavy and the photons massless? Someone had the idea, and it sounded so slimy to me that I never believed it was right. If there's a background field in nature, a uniform background field that we can't see called the Higgs field, and if photons don't interact with that field, all particles are massless originally. Photons don't interact with the field, they just move at the speed of light. But if W and Z, if these heavy particles that mediate the weak force, if they interact with that field, it's like trying to swim through molasses. They get resistance to their motion, and they slow down, and they act like massive particles. So at a fundamental scale, they're all massless, and the forces are described by exactly the same theory. But due to this accident of nature, the fact that this Higgs field formed in the early universe, as the universe curled down, the weak force looks very different than the electromagnetic force. And then the idea came, well, if it's true for the W and Z particles, maybe it's true for all the other particles. Maybe the particles that interact more strongly with the Higgs field act heavier, and the ones that interact less strongly act weaker. It's a beautiful idea, but as I say, it just seems slimy. You know, it's just so simple. Now, in envisaging an invisible field that solves all our problems is not what science is all about. It's what religion is all about. But the neat thing about science is it says if this field exists, if I smack it hard enough at one point, really hard at one point, it'll pop up particles associated with that field called Higgs particles. So all we got to do is build an accelerator that will smack empty space hard enough at a given point and will produce Higgs particles. That was the prediction. And lo and behold, the Large Hadron Collider is built, and it's produced particles that look like Higgs, and they sound like Higgs. We don't know yet if they're the Higgs particles, but again, if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, we think it's a duck. It's a remarkable thing. Now, what does it have to do with cosmology? It says two things. One, our existence is an accident. It's really an accident, because if the Higgs field didn't form, all particles would be massless, essentially, and we wouldn't be around. Two, it says it's reasonable to believe there are invisible background fields that permeate space. And that's exactly the kind of field you need to make inflation happen. So, it gives two bits of sort of fundamental evidence that the ideas behind what I said are right. And so it's remarkably important if it's true. As I say, I thought it'd be wrong. And I'm surprised, but then I'm always surprised if I'm not surprised.
I don't know. Questions? Yeah?
If the universe came from quantum fluctuations, how is it possible that baby universes can grow to an old universe and don't collide with other baby universes?
Well, we don't know if baby universes can form in our universe. Well, we certainly know, we don't even know if you might be able to create them in the laboratory. But the neat thing about general relativity is it acts like magic. And if you created by a quantum fluctuation a baby universe that expanded, in our universe, what would it look like? It would look like it was collapsing from the outside. It would look like it would collapse to be a black hole and disappear from our universe. So if baby universes are created in space, what they do is they kind of pinch off and they form their own universe, but they become invisible in our universe. They become separated from our universe. Because you can expand from the inside and contract from the outside, the miracle of general relativity. So if baby universes are forming right now, we wouldn't know about it. But the people who lived in those universes eventually would, if they had the right characteristics to last long enough. Okay? So it could be happening right now. In fact, if the laws of physics are that way, it must be happening right now. In our space, or literally they're creating space that didn't exist before that decouples from our universe. And they're happening elsewhere where our universe isn't.
Could we find any experimental evidence for that? Or is it by definition invisible?
No, the only experimental evidence we have is that quantum fluctuations like this happen. Let me give you I said they're responsible for most of the mass of the proton, but let me talk about even more importantly. Quantum mechanics was developed at the beginning of this century to be able to explain the energy levels of last century, thank you. To be able to explain the colors of light, the spectrum of light emitted by hydrogen. It was inexplicable before quantum mechanics. We understand electrons jump between levels. The problem is, when you use quantum mechanics to calculate those levels, you come up with the wrong answer. Well, it's right, except to an accuracy of one part in a million. But that bothered physicists, because we could measure things to better than one part in a million, gave the wrong answer. And they gave the wrong answer, because a hydrogen atom isn't just a proton and an electron. If what we're saying is true, a hydrogen atom's sitting there, but all the time there are virtual particle-antiparticle pairs, say electrons and their antiparticles called positrons, popping in and out of empty space. And when an electron-positron pair pops into empty space, well, the positron, which is positive, gets pushed out this direction. The electron, which is negative, gets pulled in, and they exist for a while, and then they disappear. But for a while, they change the charge distribution inside of a hydrogen atom in a way we can calculate from first principles. And then the calculation can be done to 9 decimal places, and it's the best prediction in all of physics, called quantum electrodynamics. We predict the energy levels of hydrogen exactly right to 9 decimal places, but only if we include virtual particles. So we not only know those processes happen, they produce the best predictions in all of physics when you compare it to experiment. So they exist, whether you like it or not.
All right, final question for this physical part of the evening. Who?
Here's one. Yeah, I think you're getting the microphone. He's bringing it to you.
Yep.
Ja, ik heb een mooie serie gezien die heet Through the Wormhole met Morgan Freeman.
I'll translate.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
En daar hebben ze een soort M-theory, waarbij er verschillende universums naast elkaar liggen. En mijn idee, ik hoorde net zeggen dat er een flat universum is. En ondersteunt dat dan ook die theorie dat die als een soort domino-spel die universums naast elkaar leggen. En dat daar is de oerknal. Dat is net iets anders, dat die universums tegen elkaar komen. En dat de expansie verklaart. Ik weet niet of mijn vraag een beetje
okay.
duidelijk
is. Well, what was the movie called?
Through the Wormhole. It's a documentary.
I know the show.
You've seen it?
No, I don't watch TV, especially when I'm on it.
Not even wormholes on TV?
Well,
you're not watching?
I'm on TV too much to turn
okay.
it on.
The theory goes there's all these parallel universes.
What's a domino spell?
they're like dominoes and influencing each other?
Well, look, I mean, you shouldn't believe everything you see on TV, first of all, even when I'm saying it. I heard the word M-theory.
Yeah.
And the nice thing, the thing to realize is that it's right now it's all talk. M-theory doesn't make any predictions. M-theory is a beautiful mathematical idea which may form the basis of string theory. Well, they're all what?
Flat universes.
Oh, they're not. No. There's no. They look on the TV. I mean, we draw pictures of a higher dimensional space. How can we draw it? Well, we turn our space into a two-dimensional space, just for the point of the camera to make a picture, and we draw it as a flat piece of paper. Then we draw another one, and then we draw another one, just to indicate there can be many. If the universe has extra dimensions. 1 millimeter in the extra dimension, there could be a whole other universe. We can't get there because it's not in our universe, but there could be literally a whole universe located a millimeter away in some extra dimension. But how can you picture that? We picture it as a bunch of flat planes, but that's just for the picture. They're not flat. It's just so that animators can draw things and TV people can make TV shows.
Okay. I could recommend to watch every now and then.
Well, I do every now and then.
Well, actually, you have your lectures, some of your lectures on YouTube, isn't it?
Yeah, and I actually am on lots of TV programs, right. But only late at night. When you turn it on, I'll wake you up.
Okay, great. Talking about waking up, we've seen a lot of physics, heard a lot of physics, but every now and then there popped in some kind of philosophy remarks.
Very bad philosophy, I'm sure I'll be told.
Well, we brought in a real philosopher just to check what you were doing there.
Uh-huh.
We have Professor Herman Philipse on the front row, but he'll be coming to his chair, I hope. Herman Philipse is a distinguished professor of philosophy at the University of Utrecht, and he's, for example, well known for his most recent book called God in the Age of Science. And we have asked him to listen to Lawrence Krauss, and especially to read his last book, A Universe from Nothing.
And
to
great comment. Punishment.
Pardon?
That's great punishment for him.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Well, like I said, it's two atheists on the same stage, so I guess it will be okay.
But let me make it clear that I'm not an atheist.
You're not.
He's an anti-theist.
I'm an anti-theist.
Okay.
Let me make that clear. I cannot say with 100% certainty that there is no God. I can say with 100% certainty that I wouldn't want to live in a universe with one.
Talking about philosophy. Okay. Professor Philipse. We've seen a lot of cosmology, but please connect us to the philosophy.
All right, so when I was asked to take part in this session, I first asked the organizers, why don't you ask a cosmologist, because he will have a very interesting cosmological discussion. And they said, no, there is all kinds of theology involved. And I said, well, why should I discuss theology with Professor Krauss, because I would call myself an atheist, and he calls himself an anti-theist, but I think the difference
will not be very, very big indeed.
Exactly.
And then in the end they said, well, we invited you because you can speak English. So, okay.
let's not that. True. Now, it's not true.
It's one of us. Okay.
Of course, I'm not a cosmologist. I have some interest in cosmology. When I spent my sabbaticals in Princeton, which I did in the 1990s, I used to follow cosmology courses, so I'm interested. And I have many questions, but you have to see the point of view from which I'm asking these questions. So what are philosophers doing? Philosophers are, first of all, interested in logic. What types of argument are valid arguments and what types of argument are not valid arguments? Then they're interested in philosophy of science. For instance, what is the likelihood of a specific hypothesis? Of course, we have hypotheses that are very well confirmed. We have also hypotheses that are very speculative. And I'm interested, when I looked at a scientific theory such as Darwinism, well, how certain is the theory? What is the evidence? How likely does the evidence make the theory, and so on? And all kinds of instruments we developed in order to assess that. And then, of course, we are interested in our general world picture.
They're waiting for him to fix it.
Yeah.
Okay.
It has been fixed?
We hope so.
You can hear me?
Yes.
very good. So the last interest of a philosopher is the general world picture. How should we relate religion to science, for instance? Well, there are lots of views on this. Now, I have a few questions, but the ideas that we are going to discuss, although we agree among lots and lots of things. So my first question is concerned with the Kraussian hypothesis about the origin of the universe. Mm-hmm. Now, most of the stuff we heard this evening is quite standard physics and cosmology, but I think there is a specific hypothesis which is defended by Krauss and which you might summarize very, very briefly by saying that, the universe originates from nothing, first from quantum mechanical processes, plus inflation. So these two big parts of the theory he joins together. He supposes that when particles pop into existence and disappear again, that's a process we have studied quite well in quantum mechanics, but he extrapolates that to the universe as a whole and plugs in inflation, and then we get the origin of our universe, very, very briefly.
Yeah.
Now, of course, there are many other hypotheses about the Big Bang theory and so on. So there is, for instance, the bouncing universe hypothesis, and there are all kinds of other hypotheses. So my first question would be, are these pure speculations of theoretical physicists, or can we form predictions on the basis of these speculations, which has been confirmed? How does your speculation, how is it related to the other possible scenarios of the origin of the universe? And is there any empirical way of deciding this, or don't we know it? Now, there is a quote in your book. I read the book.
Very good.
So there is a quote.
Although all that matters is buying it. You don't have to read it.
Ah, that's right. That's true for my book as well. Now, one thing you say on page Roman 13 is that...
Sounds religious.
No, okay. Roman numbering.
Yeah, okay.
All science suggests that this is how our universe could have arisen, and then you stress could, and you say, I stress the word could here because we may never have enough empirical information to resolve this question unambiguously. So it seems to be the case that you acknowledge that the theory is quite speculative and that we can't decide... Well, empirically. There is another quote on page 72. Until we have a theory of quantum gravity, as it is called, we can't trust extrapolations that go beyond this limit. So I phoned one of my quantum gravity colleagues at the University of Utrecht. In fact, she moved to Nijmegen. And I said, well, this theory of Krauss, how speculative is it? What is the likelihood? And she says, well, this is very, very speculative. Lots of physicists won't engage with this type of theory. So my first question is, well, how seriously should we take this hypothesis? Now, the second question...
Shall we do the first question first?
Yeah.
I'm chomping at the bit.
All right.
So you ask how reasonable is this compared to other ideas, and the answer is this one's right. But no, to be a little less facetious... There's nothing, the details are extremely speculative about how it may have happened, but there's nothing speculative about the processes. Namely, let me make it quite clear, there are other ideas about a bouncing universe, but no physicists take them seriously. They're really ugly. The only people who like them are the people who wrote them down, but they're so contrived without any fundamental ideas associated with them that it's an embarrassment that we talk about them in public. But look, the Big Bang happened unambiguously. Let's get to the things that we know. The Big Bang, we can extrapolate the history of the Big Bang back to a millionth of a second, and we get everything right. So all the interesting stuff that we don't know happened in the first millionth of a second. Okay. Now, the point is, how can we empirically test these ideas? Because you're right, without empirical tests, it's philosophy. And
theology.
Who cares? And so...
He's getting nasty.
What's really remarkable is we look for ways to test, and in fact, there's a way you can test for inflation, as opposed to bouncing universes, that doesn't depend upon just talk. Two things. One, you can calculate in inflation quantum fluctuations. You can actually do the calculation, and you can predict, and one of the most amazing predictions of inflation, which is again unheralded, is that those quantum fluctuations at the very smallest scales get magnified and turn into everything we see. If it's really true, we are here due to quantum mechanics. All the lumps in that microwave background radiation are due to quantum mechanics. And we can predict the distribution of lumps, and we can predict, because quantum mechanics allows us to do that. And what do you get? You get exactly what we see. Now, does that prove inflation was right? No, because you've got to make a prediction that's falsifiable. So it's consistent. But one of the other neat predictions of inflation is that you not only produce lumps in matter, but you produce lumps in gravity. You produce what are called gravitational waves. And so one of the things we're looking at with the next generation of satellites is to see, look for gravitational waves. Because inflation makes certain predictions about gravitational waves coming from the early universe that would happen when this expansion happened. So it would be profoundly important. In fact, the Planck satellite, which is up there right now, is looking for gravitational waves. One of the interesting things is that this bouncing theory, besides being wrong, actually makes a very different prediction. And so you could distinguish between those ideas empirically. So there's a great deal of evidence that's consistent with inflation right now, but we haven't been able to prove it.
How many other hypotheses are in the market?
None. None from first principles. None. And I'm the first person to be skeptical of ideas. And inflation right now is the only idea from first principles that is consistent with everything we see. That doesn't mean it's right. And that's one of the reasons if I give a science lecture, which I can give at the university here, I talk about my skepticism about the tests of inflation. Most physicists nowadays would say inflation happened because we measured all this. Sure. And you shouldn't, and as a philosopher, of course, you would agree that that's inappropriate. Unless we can falsify the theory, a la Popper, then we shouldn't say we've, in fact, we don't prove, one of the other big misunderstandings of science is we never prove things to be right. We only prove things to be wrong. That's all science can do. It can never prove anything to be right.
Because Professor
Krauss, you seem to like to talk about your theory being right.
It's not my theory. Yeah, it's
the theory, okay? Uh-huh. You use the word right and wrong quite a lot. So
likely,
well,
whenever
I use the word right, what you should interpret to me is not wrong. There's a huge difference.
Okay.
There's a huge difference. What's wrong, so let me get to the sentence I was going to say. Science can prove things wrong. It can prove things wrong by making a prediction that disagrees with experiment. If you make a prediction and it disagrees with the experiment, you throw the theory out. That's what's great about science. No matter how elegant or beautiful or desirable the theory looks to you, you throw it out like yesterday's newspaper. And all you do is keep doing that with the wrong theories, and the theories that you haven't yet been proved wrong, we think have more likelihood of being right. So this theory, these ideas are, first of all, the notion of inflation is very well founded, but the notion of quantum gravity creating spontaneous universes, if gravity is a quantum mechanical theory and we don't know the theory, because space and time become quantum mechanical variables and because quantum mechanics requires fluctuations, it is a required part of the theory that spaces will be created from nothing. We don't know how, but any theory of quantum gravity will allow for that possibility. So that's also not speculative, even though we don't have the theory. Now, it could be, and I'll admit this, it could be that at some fundamental scale, gravity is inconsistent with quantum mechanics. In fact, Gerard de Tooft, who's here in Holland and has a good track record, thinks that maybe quantum mechanics is wrong at some scale. I think he's wrong. But he's probably the only one who's arguing for that, but we don't know the answer yet. So, you know, the point is, it's plausible. All I argue is that everything, extrapolating what we know now, makes it completely plausible. And it could have been different. It could have been that the universe isn't flat. It could have been that it isn't dominated by dark energy. It could have been, lots of things could have been the case.
It could even have been created by God.
Well, it could have been, and let me point that out. I can't prove it wasn't. I can't prove there's not a teapot orbiting Jupiter either. But it's unlikely. Okay. And so, I don't think science can ever disprove the notion of God. But it's a huge leap from arguing, you know, I can't prove there's no purpose to the universe. All I can say is, and maybe I'm answering some of your questions, all I can say is there's no evidence of purpose.
Okay, Professor Philipse.
Very nice. So if we talk in terms of likelihood, of course, we cannot give specific numbers to this likelihood, but you would say this is the only theory that fits with our physical background knowledge and that, can develop in testable shapes in the end,
yeah,
or something
and it may
like
be
that.
Wrong,
and we have to do the physical work in order to develop it further. Well, that's very clarifying.
Are you satisfied with that?
I completely agree. Yes.
Good. Okay.
There is a lot of work to be done, but of course
there's a lot of work to be done, which is why it's worth young people here going into physics.
Now let's go to another element. I'm not sure how seriously you take that element, but you touch upon what philosophers and theologians very often call the problem of fine-tuning of physical constants, and you introduce a multiverse hypothesis, and you say, well, maybe the specific shape of all our laws of nature with the physical constants is completely accidental, because there are many, many different universes, and of course the universe in which we are living is a universe that enables human life to develop, or life to develop in general, and galaxies to be formed, but there are many other universes, and so on and so on. Now, interestingly, in some place of your book, you use Occam's razor as an argument.
Uh-huh.
And let me...
I didn't know I actually used the term.
Yes, you do. Oh, it's page 146 in the English edition. And he says that you say that we should reject theism, so the idea that God exists, because of Occam's razor. So you accept Occam's razor as a methodological tool. Now, what is Occam's razor? Well, Occam was a medieval philosopher, but Occam's razor is the idea that we prefer a theory that is simpler over a theory that is more complex, because we think that the simpler theory has more likelihood to be true. Now, my question is the following. If we want to explain the fine-tuning of the laws of nature in our universe, we might compare two different hypotheses. One hypothesis is this multiverse hypothesis. The other hypothesis is the hypothesis of God, who wanted to create humans in the end. So in fact, if he created the universe in this cumbersome way we now know, and if he created humans by this very, very cumbersome strategy of evolution, then at least the one thing he had to do is to fine-tune the constants of the laws of nature in such a way that in our universe, life could develop, galaxies could be formed, and so on. So we have two explanations for the fine-tuning of the laws of nature. One is the multiverse hypothesis. There are many, many universes, maybe infinitely many universes, and it's just accidental that in our universe the laws of nature have this and this shape. The other hypothesis is the hypothesis of a God who wanted the universe we are living in to be fine-tuned so that life could develop. Now, I would argue that the God hypothesis is much simpler than the multiverse hypothesis, because God, by definition, is the simplest being there can be, according to my theologist friends.
Oh.
So the multiverse hypothesis is very, very complicated. You postulate an infinity of universes in order to explain something in our universe. In the other hypothesis, you just postulate one thing in order to explain things in our universe. So if you really accept Occam's razor, you should become a theist and end being an anti-theist.
Okay.
So what's your response to that?
Okay, well, my response is clearly a misunderstanding on your part.
Oh, really? maybe your book wasn't really clear then.
First of all, I'm not surprised you got the wrong answer from theological colleagues, because they always get the wrong answer. Clearly, I don't want to spend too much time on God, because I think it's a waste of time. But clearly, any being that could create a universe as complex as ours must at least be as complex as our universe.
Oh, no, that's a Dawkins mistake.
Well, I think it's hard to imagine an intelligence that would know, for example, to fine-tune the constants of nature, that would understand the four forces of nature, that would have all of that without at least the complexity of our brains, which can also work that out.
No, no, God doesn't have any brains. And
yeah, you're absolutely right.
All his knowledge is just one and the same thing.
But let's get beyond that. Because, you know, you can argue... I mean, you know, I can argue about fairy tales... you know, leprechauns, too, but let's not. The key point is that, in fact, this argument about fine-tuning is wrong. I said that the cosmological constant... the energy of empty space has to be what it is, not much bigger than what it is, so that galaxies would form. But it could have been zero. And zero would be much more beautiful mathematically, much simpler, and life would still exist. So it's not, so you know, there, so that in fact, it's not, it happens that it can't be much bigger, but if there were a God, God could have made it zero, and it'd be much pure. In fact, not only would it be a much better universe, but in fact, we live in the worst of all possible universes as far as the future of life is concerned. you can show that life will end earlier in a universe with non-zero energy than it would in a universe with zero energy. So if God was really interested in creating a universe in which life would persist, then he would have, she would have created a universe in which the energy of empty space was zero.
Do you know?
Let me finish. The second thing is, there's a huge difference, which, you know, may or may not be relevant to Occam's razor, and as a philosopher, you can tell me this, but the point is, one is well-motivated and one isn't. We didn't invent the multiverse to solve this problem. Let me make that quite clear. We were driven to a multiverse by inflation and string theory, both of which were developed to solve other problems. They're well motivated by fundamental physics measurements. And they lead to this prediction. So they weren't, unlike God, who was invented by humans to solve things they didn't understand when they didn't understand anything. The multiverse is a reasonable postulate that we've been driven to based on experiment. And that's a hugely different thing. And moreover, it's in some ways testable. So the point is that one is a well-motivated hypothesis and one is a completely unwell-motivated hypothesis, especially even if I accept the theism or deism, you can tell me which is the right way to think of this, argument that there was a God that was necessary to create our universe. Then that claim that there is some purpose to our universe, which I can't see, there's no evidence for in any of the data, there's no evidence that the universe was created for us, there's no evidence that we're centerpieces of it, there's no evidence that it's been designed in any way so we could be here. But if it was, it's a huge leap from that kind of vague God to the God of all the world's religions, who cares about humans, who intervenes in human affairs, and is sadistic and awful. And what amazes me is that people who even argue in favor of theism in that regard make this unwarranted giant leap to a God that's involved in human affairs when in fact there's definitely no evidence of that. So the point is, to summarize, the motivation of a multiverse is not based on solving this problem of fine-tuning, which really isn't the problem. It's based on experiment and theory. It's much more well-motivated than God, but even if you allow for a God, that God, an impotent God who just creates the universe and then gets out of the business, that God is very different than the God that most of the people talk about in church and synagogue and mosques.
Again, satisfied?
Let me make two comments on what you said and then raise another issue.
Okay.
So one of the comments is that clearly you haven't followed the theological arguments very, very well.
Sure, because they're relevant.
No?
They're relevant to me as a cosmologist.
No. Let me finish. The theological arguments stress the fact that, of course, they don't introduce God as a hypothesis in order to explain something, because God somehow is revealed to them a long time ago, and it's not a natural hypothesis. But given the fact that God exists, they can explain very well, and it's very probable, that a universe would develop in which life can exist. So they have an answer to the fine-tuning problem. Now, of course, physicists develop their multiverse theory for various reasons, and in fact for other reasons than fine-tuning. I agree completely with you there. The theory can solve fine-tuning as well. So the multiverse hypothesis is a solution for fine-tuning as well, and for other problems. And in fact, in your book, you propose it as a solution for the fine-tuning problem.
As one possible solution.
Yes.
But not the kind of fine-tuning you're talking about.
So still, the theologian might say, well, my hypothesis is much simpler because I postulate only one entity, namely God,
that is omnipotent, yeah, that can create universes, indeed, that is otherwise
indeed,
undetectable.
Yes, I agree.
I don't know whether it's a ridiculous hypothesis.
Let me just finish.
Yeah.
So if you use the Occam's razor, they are right to say that their solution is simpler than the multiverse solution.
No.
Now, okay. Now, another thing is that...
Only if they say God is simpler, and I don't agree with you, and I don't agree with the theologians.
From the medieval epoch, all theologians said that God was the simplest entity.
They didn't know the Earth orbited the sun either. Well, they can say whatever they want,
sure.
But they're not right.
Anyway, now, another
okay.
Another point is, and that will lead to my last question, is that it's typical for cosmologists who didn't study the philosophy of religion very carefully, like that they move from one problem to another problem without noticing.
Yeah.
So you move from the fine-tuning problem to the problem of evil, because you say, well, God would never have created this universe, because if we look into the future of this universe, the future is horrible, as you explained, there will be a big cool, and so on and so on, and life will not persist, and so on. We all know these things. So you move from one problem to the other, whereas if you really do philosophy of religion, you should stick to one problem and explain it very, very clearly. Now, a footnote to this last observation that our universe is such that the future will be horrible, of course that is already predicted in the Bible, because there is the end of times. So what are you talking about? All right, but this brings me, in fact, to...
I was at the Vatican talking about that once. We'll talk about that.
Lovely.
Okay.
I would have loved to be present. Now, okay, so let's go to my last issue. If religious people want to take into account the fact that scientific progress has refuted lots and lots of their views, and you mentioned some, then I think that they have a lot of options. And I like to map these options in terms of a decision tree. So suppose you're a religious believer and you see that, well, Newton's view that God had to interfere in order to keep the orbits of the planets stable and so on, that all these theories have been solved, in this case by Laplace, and that Darwin solved the problem of all these complex living things, how can they develop, and so on. So religious views on the universe have been falsified all the time by scientific progress. We all agree about that. Now, what should the religious person do here? I think there are a few options. Now, one option is to claim, well, religion doesn't make any claims to truth at all. It's only about giving meaning to our life, and the church practices are very good because they inspire people to being nice to your neighbors or bomb them or whatever. So that's... That's one option. No specific factual claims at all in religion. Then the next option is, yes, religious people make factual claims, but they have an instrument of knowing them, say a capacity of knowing them, which is such that these claims don't need to be supported by arguments or evidence or whatever. And your famous compatriot, Alvin Plantinga, who is in the University of Notre Dame, did you ever discuss with him?
Yeah, it was
I mean,
awful.
he developed this view in great detail, and in the last number of the New York Review of Books, there was a review of his last book, which is about the relation between science and religion, and he claims that religion supports science much better than the denial of religion supports science. Now, okay, so you should engage with them.
I did.
And then, of course, there are people who say, yes, we make factual claims as religious people, and we should support these claims in the same way as scientists support their claims. That is, we should do this by Bayesian probability theories or whatever. Richard Swinburne, did you ever discuss with him?
I know of, no, we haven't had the discussion, but I know
of. Okay. Yeah. Now, what I lack in your book is that you say nasty things about all these religious people, and sometimes also about the philosophers.
I don't say about people, I say about their ideas.
Oh, okay. About their ideas, I'm sorry. Theologians, you mentioned somewhere.
Yeah, well, they don't really have ideas, but go on.
Okay. So what I would reproach you is that you don't really discuss their arguments in detail. So you just dismiss them by these funny jokes. I laugh about them as well. I mean, they're very funny indeed. But I mean, if you would really engage with the arguments, I think they would be. There is much more probability that they will be convinced. And you think it's a waste of time, maybe?
Well, I've done it. Look, I mean, one of the reasons I wrote this book is I've been subjected to these things a lot. I've been on panels many times with theologians, and as I say, I've been at the Vatican talking about the far future of the universe with theologians and philosophers and Vatican officials, etc. And I think the point is, what I really wanted to say, and in fact, while you and other people claim there's a lot of things in my book where I talk about this, there's maybe two or three pages in my book where I mention theologians or God, and that's more than enough. And the point is, the really important thing to point out is that God is irrelevant. What I don't want to give the impression of is that the question of the existence of God is of vital importance to scientists. As my friend Steve Weinberg, who's also an atheist and a Nobel Prize winning physicist, would say, physicists don't even think enough about God to know that they're atheists. The question never comes up. You'll never ever go to a cosmology meeting or a physics meeting or a particle physics meeting and hear the word God mentioned. It's completely irrelevant
so
to understand the universe.
So
we don't need the God hypothesis never comes up. We never need to talk about it. It doesn't add anything. And so as I know I do say somewhere in the book that God is essentially irrelevant. And my point is to show how you can discuss a universe without mentioning the word God. Not to show that, but how it's plausible. And I will say that in the effort to reach out, what I said at the Vatican I think is true. I said it facetiously, but I think it's true anyway. I said to the theologians there, you have to listen to me, but I don't have to listen to you. And the reason is just but there's a reason. I wasn't even being patronizing, even though it sounds like it. What I meant by that is to do sensible theology, namely to try and interpret the possibility of divinity and be sensible, it has to be in accord with what we know to be true about the universe, the evidence of reality. Therefore, to be a sensible theologian, you have to try and keep track at some level about what we know about the universe. In fact, even St. Augustine said that. As he used to advise people, he said, if you go out and try and convert the heathen, you better, if you don't understand nature, you'll look pretty stupid and they won't listen to you. So you have to, so theologians have to understand physics in some level, at some basic level. But it doesn't work the other way around, because to understand the universe, I don't have to know anything about people's ideas of God or divinity or evil or any of the things that people invent. I just have to figure out how the universe works. That's all that science tries to do. And for science to do it, it doesn't, the how question is, all these issues about God become irrelevant. So it's a one-way street. And that's why I don't have to talk to them. That's why I don't have to care what they say. But I would care what they say if it had a positive impact on me as a scientist, or if I had any evidence that what they had to say and the religions on which they based their work had any positive impact on humanity. But I am 100% convinced that that is exactly wrong. That in fact, believing in myths and fairy tales has been and continues to be responsible for bad actions and bad policies. And we eventually have to move to a world where we grow up beyond those fairy tales that were created and don't create these artificial things called areas of pseudo scholarship where people try and build, with Plantenia is a perfect example, try and build epicycles within epicycles in order to understand the resurrection of Christ. It's just a waste of time.
The problem is,
we have a friendly crowd here to me, so that's a problem.
The problem is, I couldn't agree more.
Okay. I know you couldn't. Well, I know.
Can I ask you
a devil's advocate?
I have a question, a personal question to Lawrence Krauss then. You are very, perhaps even emotional about this. Is that true?
I become more so. As I watch the vociferousness with which people respond, all I do in my work and in the book is I say, is it possible to imagine that the universe could be created without God? Is it a reasonable question to ask, and is it possible? And all you have to do is ask that question, and you're suddenly attacked as being a strident atheist. And that is, I think, made me more sympathetic to Richard Dawkins than I ever was before. Because people become unbelievably defensive. And when are people defensive?
Not here, but in the States.
Yeah, but when are people defensive when you ask a question? When they have something to be defensive about, when they're insecure about it. And I guess I showed you at dinner this unfortunate photograph that I have came from Australia of this little kid at a demonstration. It looks like he's 3 years old with his mother taking a picture of the little kid that says, he's got a sign up, 3-year-old kid with his little baby brother here. Sign says, behead all those who insult the prophet.
Uh-huh.
Okay, I mean, that kind of insanity can only happen when we allow ourselves to be deluded by myth and superstition. And if I don't care what people believe, it's their actions that matter. But when they believe delusions, inevitably their actions become irrational. And that's what worries me, especially in the modern world when we have to face the real challenges of a 20th century, 21st century of overpopulation, global warming, energy. All these things are going to exacerbate political tensions. If we don't face the world for what it is, then I think we're doomed.
But there's all kinds of subjects you'll never hear on a particle physics conference, like God.
Absolutely.
So why is a physicist talking about this?
Because the reason I talk about it is because, well, actually there are two reasons. I like to seduce people in every way I can, by the way.
I thought it was provoke people.
But teaching is seduction.
Okay.
And so I wrote a book called The Physics of Star Trek. Why did I write that book? Well, Star Trek is fun. But I wrote the book because people are afraid of physics, but they're not afraid of Star Trek. So how can I communicate to people the wonders of physics? I can use Star Trek to seduce them into learning about wormholes and warp drive and time travel and quantum mechanics and things they wouldn't otherwise learn. This religious question...
It's your friends.
Yeah, hey, there it is. Okay, great. This religious question of why there's something rather than nothing is something that everyone asks themselves the question of. And therefore, it allows me a motivation to seduce people to learn about modern cosmology. If I just gave a book on modern cosmology, well, some people will read it. But I can reach a much broader audience. And so my interest always, always has been to celebrate the wonders of the real universe rather than to decry this lunacy of the imaginary universe. So I can use that innate human desire for God, which is innate, I think, to try and motivate people to learn about the real universe. And my hope is that as people learn more about the real universe, they'll realize the need for these other artificial things is less and less. But that's a secondary desire.
Shall we allow for one question from the audience? Okay.
Thank you, by the way, for being the devil's advocate so nicely. I appreciate it.
Which is a book by Richard Dawkins, of course. Yes.
I have one question to both. First to Lawrence Krauss. Have you forgotten do you dislike also Spinoza's God, or do you just not know about him?
Who?
And
Spinoza.
And
Spinoza's God.
God is nature. And well, and so the same question is to phrase differently to our philosopher. Have you forgotten about Spinoza's God?
Well, I'm sure he hasn't, because he's a philosopher, and I haven't either. I mean, Einstein often talked about God, and he said his God was the God of Spinoza. What he meant was that by that. What Einstein meant, and I'm more familiar with what Einstein meant than Spinoza, although I've read Spinoza, but Einstein's easier to understand, for me, is that an awe, an appreciation of the wonder of the fact that the universe is comprehensible, that there's order in the universe, is something that produced a spiritual awe in Einstein. It produces a spiritual awe in me. And for those people who claim that when we get rid of religion and we just have science, we'll get rid of that beautiful spiritual solace we get. My argument is, if you just understood the universe right, you'd understand the real universe is so much more spiritually satisfying than the universe of myth and superstition, that in fact you'll get your spiritual satisfaction in the same sense I think that Spinoza did and Einstein did.
Okay, Herman Philipse.
The question is, have I forgotten about Spinoza's God? Of course not. Do we accept the idea of Spinoza's God, that is a God that is identical with the universe? The problem, of course, is that because Spinoza thought that God is identical with the universe, he said a lot of things about the universe, that is God, that a modern physicist could not accept. So I think that the way he developed his theory is unacceptable. It wasn't experimental science, it was just deduction from a certain number of axiomas, and the things he said about the universe are untenable as well. So I would reject Spinoza's God, both for methodological reasons and for reasons of truth.
A much more knowledgeable answer than mine.
Well, we can spell this out, but...
Okay. We can and will talk after the next break, but outside this program, because we're running out of time. I'd like to thank Lawrence Krauss again. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And of course, his worthy opponent, Herman Philipse.
Well, it's okay. Thank you.
We have left one issue in this evening. That's a column by one of our columnists, in this case Jelle Reumer. He's the director of the Natural History Museum in Rotterdam. Unfortunately, he has another museum, which is based in Spain, so we convinced him to deliver his column in the form of a video. Please, Jelle Reumer.
De oude Grieken die hadden het ontzettend makkelijk. Voor alles wat ze niet snapten, waren er goden. Ze hadden Afrodite om te verklaren dat je verliefd werd. Helios om te verklaren dat de zon netjes om de aarde draait, want zo zag het eruit in ieder geval. En ze hadden Poseidon om te verklaren dat er af en toe een schip verging. Tegenwoordig weten we dat daar allerlei andere processen aan ten grondslag liggen. En hebben we die goden dus niet meer nodig. Toch zijn er nog twee dingetjes die de wetenschap niet helemaal kan verklaren. En als de wetenschap het wel kan verklaren, dan vrees ik dat we het eigenlijk niet snappen. En die twee dingetjes, dat is ten eerste het ontstaan van het heelal. Je kunt ook zeggen het ontstaan van eigenlijk alles. Alle atomen waar u en ik uit bestaan, de stoel waar u nu op zit of de bomen hier achter mij. En het tweede is het ontstaan van het leven. Je kan ook zeggen het ontstaan van iedereen, maar hoe dus dode dingen tot leven zijn gekomen. Want die stoel waar u op zit is echt dood, maar uzelf niet. Bij die twee onderwerpen hebben dus niet Afrodite, Helios en Poseidon, maar wel God of goden nog een beetje een voet tussen de deur. En dat komt omdat eigenlijk dit soort verklaringen die gegeven worden tegen onze intuïtie indruisen. U kent allemaal wel die kreet, en daar werd dit programma ook mee aangekondigd, van eerst is er niets en dat ontploft dan. Kent u dit boek? Dit is een dagboek van Andries Knevel. En ik ga even een stukje voorlezen uit dat boek, want die zin die staat er ook in. Weliswaar nu niet gebezigd door een wetenschapper, maar door Henk Haaghoort, de baas van de Nederlandse publieke omroep en een overtuigd christen. Eerst was er niets en dat is dan ook nog een keer ontploft. Henk Haaghoort spot in Broadcast Magazine met de kern van het evolutionisme. Maar de evolutionisten maken het er dan ook wel naar. Dan komen er nog wat uitweidingen en dan eindigt Andries Knevel, onze nationale knuffeltheoloog, met het zinnetje toeval of ontwerp. Dat is de kern van de discussie. En voor toeval is een groter geloof nodig dan voor ontwerp. Volgens mij wordt hier het scheermes van Ockham een beetje misbruikt. Eerst is er dus helemaal niets en dan is er iets en wel heel veel iets. En dat iets, dat gaat dan op een bepaald moment ook nog leven. Dus het is volkomen contra-intuïtief hoe dat kan gebeuren. En omdat het contra-intuïtief is, omdat we het niet snappen, blijft daar toch nog een klein beetje ruimte voor God over. Het geeft ruimte aan fantasie. En fantasie is iets waar wij ontzettend goed in zijn. Ik weet niet of u wel eens afgelopen zomer op de kinderpagina van de NRC hebt gekeken. Daar heeft een hele tijd een serietje foto's werd gepubliceerd, gemaakt door kinderen meestal, soms ook volwassenen, van allerlei dingen waar je iets in kunt zien. Dat stond vorige week nog weer samengevat in de NRC, wat overigens Nieuwe Amsterdamse Courant betekent, zoals u tegenwoordig weet. Dit soort fotootjes met allerlei enge dingen. U ziet hier een boom, een boomstronk. Maar eigenlijk is die boomstronk natuurlijk een enge heks. En verder hebben we nog een vis hier en allerlei draken en zo. Kortom, we kunnen dus dingen zien die er niet zijn. Ik vraag me trouwens ook af wat het verschil is tussen een boomstronk die eruit ziet als een draak of een wolf die een hond is eigenlijk, of een geroosterde boterham waar het gezicht van de verlosser in verschijnt. Of een witte wolk die ineens zijn moeder blijkt te wezen, liefst in een grot. De menselijke geest is dus in staat om van niets iets te maken. Dat is interessant. Ergens een ziel inleggen, terwijl er natuurlijk helemaal geen ziel in zit. Tja, hoe moet dat nu verder? Kijk, volgens de wetenschap is alles verklaarbaar. Op die twee dingen na misschien. Maar goed, dan komen Richard Dawkins en Lawrence Krauss om ons te vertellen dat we ook dat allemaal kunnen verklaren. Het ontstaan van het leven en het ontstaan van het heelal, van alles. En toch vinden we dat lastig om echt te geloven. Niet alleen u en ik, maar ook, dat lazen we net, Andries Knevel heeft daar moeite mee. En dat komt omdat het tegen onze intuïtie ingaat. En daar zit denk ik de grote uitdaging. Hoe kun je ook met je intuïtie verklaren dat iets uit niets ontstaat en dat leven uit dood ontstaat? Want dat kan natuurlijk niet. Amahula, iets kan toch niet uit niets ontstaan? En iets wat dood is, ga nou naar die stoel waar u op zit, die komt echt niet tot leven. Dus dat verklaren we niet. En daar, omdat we dat niet begrijpen, omdat dat tegen onze intuïtie ingaat, daar heeft God nog steeds een voet tussen de drempel en de deur. En de enige manier om die deur echt dicht te krijgen, is ervoor te zorgen dat we de verklaringen die gegeven worden door wetenschappers ook echt snappen. En dat ze in overeenstemming zijn met onze intuïtie. De intuïtie van lieden zoals u en ik en ook die van Andries Knevel. Intussen is Afrodite vervangen door oxytocine. Dat maakt ons verliefd. Intussen is Helios, die de zon om de aarde liet draaien, vervangen door de wetten van de zwaartekracht. Newton, die de aarde om de zon laat draaien. En inmiddels is Poseidon vervangen door af en toe een lekker lage drukgebied. Maar nu nog even de Big Bang. En nu nog even de oersoep vervangen door iets wat we ook snappen, wat we intuïtief aan kunnen voelen. Ik denk dat dat een hele mooie opgave is voor de wetenschap. Om die laatste godjes, het godje van de Big Bang en het godje van het ontstaan van het leven, pruttelend in die oersoep, om die ook nog eventjes in overeenstemming te brengen met onze intuïtie. Daar daag ik de wetenschap toe uit.
What he said, he was challenging science to give an intuition to the general public. Obviously, he wasn't here because I think you did quite well tonight. Thank you again, Lawrence Krauss. En ik ga nu even over op Nederlands. Dank u wel voor uw aanwezigheid. Het was fantastisch om u hier te hebben. De volgende keer hebben wij natuurlijk weer de derde maandag van de maand oktober een wetenschapscafé hier. Dan gaat het over wetenschappelijke collecties van skeletten en mensenhuiden tot oude vogels en stenen. Wat heb je er eigenlijk aan en wat moeten we ermee? Tot dan, tot kijk. good evening at Science Cafe Amsterdam. We're talking English, as you might hear from me right now. That's because we have a very distinguished guest who only speaks English. That's Lawrence Krauss. I'll be introducing him later on. Welcome to this. Well, I guess it will be a brilliant night. The Volkskrant Royal Dutch Academy of Sciences, Science Center Nemo, and of course the Balie are very honored to have such a special lecture at this evening, and we're very happy that so many people came to listen to it. As you also can see, the bar is open since we're a cafe, so please feel free to have a drink in between all the talk about stars and voids. You might get thirsty from that. Besides that, we have a live stream tonight, as all nights in the Science Cafe, which means that you'll be on screen. If you don't want to, you should leave now. On the other hand, when you want to be on screen, and besides that, want to say something, which will be possible because we'll have a debate afterwards, you'll have to wait for the microphone, please. Otherwise, there will be no sound to the images going all over the globe. Our guest, he's already sitting there, having a drink, hey. At the bar, we have Marijke, so she'll be happy to serve you anyway. We have Lawrence Krauss. He's a cosmologist, so he knows all about the universe and perhaps even more. He's at the Arizona State University. He's lecturing all over the world. He told me that in his university in Arizona, he has lectures with 2,000 in the audience, and that's 100 times a year or something. So we're a very intimate audience, which leaves us room to talk to Lawrence, which might be nice afterwards. But first of all, we'll be having his lecture connected to his most recent book. He's written numerous books over the years, from Physics of Star Trek to Fear of Physics, The Fifth Essence and Quintessence, all about what the universe is made of and why we shouldn't be afraid to ask questions about that. This year he published The Universe from Nothing, which is a very interesting and intriguing book, I guess. And the translation has come out in Dutch. It's called Universum uit het Niets, and it's being published by New Amsterdam, the publishers here in Amsterdam, of course. Tonight, Lawrence will be speaking about how a universe can grow from nothing and why it probably did. Later on, we'll be having a debate with our other distinguished guest, Herman Philipse. He's a philosopher in Utrecht University. We'll be having two atheists talking about the origins of everything, which might be quite interesting. Feel free to join the discussions afterwards. So, I'm very happy and honored to have Lawrence Krauss talking about nothing for at least 20 minutes.
Thank you. Oh, good, we've got that. Okay, now do I have sound? Oh, I can hear myself now. Good. Okay. First, Marijke, are you there? Could I have the drink I ordered? Okay. I just want to get that. It'll help me. I start shaking otherwise. No. In any case, it's a pleasure to be here, and I think the way it's going to work is I'm going to speak, and there's going to be a little break for an experiment, and then I'll speak again. So I want to break up my talk into two bits. Thank you so much. Here's my little... Okay, thank you. In the United States, we usually have colored water, but here we have the real thing. It's much more civilized. The subject I want to talk about is nothing, indeed, which is a very complicated subject because things have changed a lot. I want to really talk about, in the context of nothing, how things have changed, and what I want to really present to you is the biggest mystery in the universe. The purpose behind my book and behind my talk, to some extent, is to celebrate the revolutionary changes that have taken place in our understanding of the universe, And they have not only changed our picture of the past and the present, but the future, and changed completely the possibility, in fact, of understanding how our universe could have come about, as I'll talk about. And so this is one of my favorite quotes, because really, if we want to understand, the most important part of any mystery is getting to the starting point. So what I want to do is bring you to the starting point, which is what I'll do in the first half of this talk, and that will confuse you completely. I'll give you a little while to get you to recover, and then I'll talk about some of the implications of that. Okay, so the question I in principle want to address is this question: why is there something rather than nothing? It's been the last refuge of those who believe in God for a long time. As we've removed God from everywhere else in the universe, once Darwin demonstrated that life wasn't a miracle, but in fact could come about, the diversity of life on Earth could come about by evolution and natural selection. We don't yet understand the origin of life exactly, but we are pretty close. But the one question that seems to require a deity, or at least some people think it requires a deity, is this question. And I've been asked it a lot, and I want to talk about why, in fact, first of all, why it's not an interesting question. So in fact, normally the way it's answered, why is there something rather than nothing, is sort of the, you have a book, you write a book, and you begin it like this, in the beginning, and then you have a long book that tells you nothing about anything. It explains nothing. It was, in this case, was written by Iron Age peasants who didn't even know that the Earth orbited the sun. And that is supposed to address the why question. And it's appropriate that a book with no real content addresses the why question, because the why question has no content. The why question is not an interesting question, because why questions presume purpose. They presume the answer before you ask the question. If you think about it, if you have children, they will ask you why, and the answer ultimately is only because. And then you say, go to bed. Because why presumes purpose? The really interesting questions are how questions. So whenever we, the really interesting question is how could a universe, how could something come from nothing? Why is not an interesting question, even though it is the domain of much of all of theology, which is content-free, and much of philosophy, some of which is content-free, as we'll have that discussion later. Not all of which. To answer the question, however, how could something come from nothing, the thing I want to really emphasize is that science has changed the playing field of that question. Science has changed what we mean by that question because it's changed the definition of something and nothing. It does that a lot. So that's the way science works, as I'll talk about, but I'll probably talk about later because I want to get to the content. What I want to do instead of writing down the answer is I want to be governed by the universe. So this is a picture of the universe as you might see it on the night sky outside of Amsterdam. This happens to be a globular cluster, doesn't really matter. The night sky is beautiful in the country with full of stars, but the remarkable thing that we've discovered is that the stars are just the tip of a cosmic iceberg. The really important stuff is the stuff you can't see, the stuff between the stars. And that's the stuff that will determine the future of our universe. And it's our understanding of the empty space between the stars that has changed completely. And as we've changed our understanding of empty space, our ideas of nothing have evolved a lot. So that's where I want to go. Okay. Now, I don't have time to give you the full lecture I'd like to give you about the expanding universe. It is rather interesting to realize that less than 100 years ago, a human lifetime ago, the conventional picture in science was that the universe was static and eternal, and there was one galaxy, our own galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. That was the picture that was around in 1916 when Einstein developed general relativity. So we knew there was one galaxy in a static eternal universe. And that was true until 1925. And it's rather remarkable that we now know that there are at least 100 billion galaxies in our universe. Until 1925, we only knew of one of them. So 87 years ago, we knew of one, now there are 100 billion. That explains why things are so exciting, because we're only just beginning to learn about the universe on the largest scales. We're like the early map makers on Earth. And it's not too surprising that we're often surprised. And in the last two decades, we've been surprised tremendously. Well, All that changed with one of my favorite people, Edwin Hubble, who discovered that, in fact, not only was there not just one galaxy, he first discovered, in fact, that there were other galaxies, but then he made another important discovery, that the universe is expanding. He gives me great hope for humanity every time I think of him, because he began life as a lawyer and then became an astronomer. So there is hope for everyone. In any case, I don't have time to adequately describe his discovery, although we will, at some point, do an experiment that'll help you understand it in the middle. But he discovered that galaxies were moving away from us, and those galaxies that were twice as far away were twice as moving away from us twice as fast, three times as far away, three times as fast, and so on. And it turns out that does not imply we are the center of the universe, but rather that the universe is expanding. Now, once we realized it's expanding, everything changed. Because, first of all, it wasn't static and eternal, and that meant it had a beginning. That had profound implications, not just for physics, but for philosophy and theology, because the universe indeed had a beginning. We now know that beginning was 13.72 billion years ago. It's amazing we can say it with that kind of precision. Here I can say it. In my country, there are many states where it's 6,000 years old. But we know the answer. But the question then became, if the universe is expanding, will the expansion stop? That became the holy grail of 20th century cosmology. Will the expansion stop? And it turns out that Einstein's general theory of relativity was able to explain the expanding universe, and it said that gravity curves space. And our universe could exist in one of three geometries, so-called open, closed, or flat. And it's impossible to picture them because you can't picture a curved three-dimensional space. None of us can because we're three-dimensional beings. So I draw in here two-dimensional surfaces just to get an idea, a closed universe, an open universe, and a flat universe. And all what's important is that in a closed universe full of matter, the universe will expand and stop and recontract into a big crunch, the reverse of a big bang. An open universe will go on expanding forever, and a flat universe is the boundary between the two. And the question is, which universe do we live in? And that's the question we wanted to resolve so we could know the future. In fact, the reason I got into cosmology as a particle physicist is I wanted to be the first person to know how the universe would end. It seemed like a good idea at the time. Now, I want to show you how we've answered that question. As I say, I don't have much time in this first part, so I'm going to give you the data. And it's very simple. Since matter curves space, all we have to do is weigh the universe. It's really quite simple. You can go out and do it at home tonight. But here's one way we've done it. Here's a picture that's worth a thousand words. This is one way we can weigh the universe. This is a remarkable picture. It's a Hubble Space Telescope picture of a cluster of galaxies. That means every dot in this picture is a galaxy, not a star. Each of these galaxies contains 100 billion stars or so. And this cluster is 5 billion light years away. 5 billion light years. That means the light from those galaxies left those stars 5 billion years ago. They left those stars before our Earth and Sun even formed. So most of those stars don't exist anymore. And any civilizations around those stars are probably gone. So most of those stars don't exist anymore. And any civilizations around those stars are probably gone.